This is Jason Nadler from SciFi4Me speaking with Brande Roderick about her directorial debut film, Wineville.
Hello.
How are you today?
I'm doing excellent. Thank you. Really good.
Really glad to have you here. So,
Thank you.
I think for me, the biggest question I have for you, I was unfamiliar with the Wineville chicken coop murders. Until after I watched your movie, and I went to Google it to look and see what your website had to say. And then I went down just this rabbit hole and realized a lot of similarities between truth and fiction, and really just wanted to know what drew you to a story that was so closely based on those crimes.
So our story wasn't loosely based on those crimes, but the connection is that where we shot at Galliano Winery was on Wineville Road. And Wineville Road is where the chicken coop murders happened, the real life ones back in the 20s. And the town that we shot in the 20s was called Wineville. Yep. And because the publicity was so terrible for the town, they had to change the name to Mira Loma. So for us, it was more like an homage to the real town name and the fact that we shot on the real street where these chicken coop murders really happened. So we just decided to keep it and use the Wineville name, you know, just for fun. Yeah.
No, yeah. That's really a lot of fun. I'm from Long Island, and here we have the Amityville Horror. And, you know, just the house that something horrible happened, but people have made subsequent films about all kinds of unusual things.
Yeah, definitely.
So the character you play, Tess, she's a victim of abuse, but you've made her out to be a very strong, resilient woman. Tell me about how the character of Tess influenced why you wanted to make the movie and portray her in it.
Well, there were a couple things that we had in our recipe to start off with. One, it was going to be myself and my real son in real life was going to be playing my son. And I wanted to do a real character driven film where a mom will do anything to save her son, you know, like have that real dynamic and relationship. And we also had this amazing winery that my friend said, hey, you could shoot your movie here. So we had this great, you know, backdrop. Went to the winery, the writer and I, Richard Shankman, you know, went there quite a few times walking around, looking at all the different cool buildings and everything about the entire winery, and just started, you know, brainstorming back and forth and coming up with all these ideas. And that's kind of how it started. We just started with two characters and a backdrop and created this, pretty sick, disturbing story.
Well, quite disturbing. It was a lot of fun. It really took me back to the horror movies of my childhood. Had a really 70s feel for it. It was a lot of fun. So at the end of the movie, you have a confrontation between Tess and Joe. This is probably one of the darkest moments in the film. Real Cain and Abel stuff. But did you ever consider having Tess take Joe out instead of her son, Walter?
No, I don't think that ever came up. I think it was to kind of show the growth also of Walter, you know, because when he kind of shows up, he's a little bit kind of like a meat kid, you know, doesn't even know how to use a shovel. And he's just like into his Mad Libs all day, you know. So it kind of also just shows his growth and his protection of his mother as well at the end. So I kind of wanted to show his character evolution as well. So, yeah.
No, I felt that it really showed Tess's strength in the fact that when exposed to all of these things, her son is still doing the right thing. It kind of really represented her character very well. It was just, you know, the traditional horror movie ending would have had Tess taking care of everything. So that was probably my biggest surprise.
Yeah, there's, I'm hoping there's a lot, there were a lot of surprises, but yes, that's definitely a big one too.
So, yeah. So on that note, your son Keaton plays, your movie son, Walter. How was it working with him, you know, balancing being his mother and his boss on the set? How was that dynamic for you?
You know, believe it or not, I mean, it was just very natural. You know, Richard's so good at, you know, he wrote it in a way that for us was kind of very just talky, you know, like very natural for the two of us. And, you know, I thought it was fun. I loved getting to see him enjoying himself and hanging out with the other characters. Like he and Joe or Casey, you know, Casey King is his real name. You know, they'd be playing football on set and, you know, he's just having a good old time and sitting in, you know, hair and makeup, you know, getting pampered. So it was just kind of fun seeing him, you know, have fun and enjoy himself. But as far as like working together, it just was very natural. Yeah.
You know, this is your directorial debut, but you're also starring in the movie. And, you know, you hear a lot of stories about what it's, how it's a hard, it's a big challenge to direct yourself and to still be objective. What was like that mm-hmm. like for you?
Well, and producing the entire thing, taking care of everything. It was a very big challenge. And next time I won't, give myself such a big role. If, you know, if I'm, I just won't wear so many hats next time. Cause it was a big challenge, but I am so glad I did it. And, you know, it's my baby. So for me, it was like, I loved being able to have control from A to Z, because then it's like, this is what I'm presenting to the world, what I want to present to the world. So I did love that and didn't have to worry about anybody else's input. But I would delegate more next time. Yeah.
Well, at least you can say it was all yours. That was awesome.
Yeah.
Okay. So, the movie is set in 1977, as I mentioned, it really has a feel of horror movies of that era. How did those horror movies of our youth, influence you and your decisions in this movie?
Absolutely. So my directing mentor, Richard Shankman, who's also a writer and one of the producers, he and I have a very big love and affection for the late, you know, 70s horror films, and, you know, especially Texas Chainsaw Massacre and Exorcist and Psycho 60s. But, you know, just what we love, Last House on the Left, you know, all these old films. And originally the story was, we were just writing it as a, you know, a normal this day and age story. And then when we sent the script to one of Richard's friends, who's big into the film business, he said, you know what, you guys, this is really lending itself to be a 70s horror film. And we were like, oh, wow. You know, we never really thought about that. And then we thought, what a great idea, because we were kind of picking off, you know, from all these old, you know, horror films, the ideas and thoughts. And so we decided to make it into, you know, film and set in 1978. And I'm so glad that we did. It just gives it another wonderful element to the story.
It definitely has a feel of that era. Yeah. Taking cell phones out of the equation definitely amps up the drama. Everyone had the ability to call everyone else.
Yeah, exactly. And when the girl asks Joe, you guys do have a phone here, right? So it's like,
absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah.
So although it is, you know, set in the 70s and everything, it has a much more modern sense of storytelling. Did you draw on influences from the current period as well?
I don't know that we were trying to draw on any, you know, current period or anything, as much as just wanting to really have a horror film with a plot. Okay. I didn't want a typical slasher, you know, I wanted it to be a real family dynamic. And Richard always, you know, likes to reference it as like a Greek tragedy.
Absolutely.
But Yeah, so I think more just really having that storyline and that plot. And that's the one thing I think that I'm most proud of with this film is that there's actually a storyline and all these twists and turns and things that are going to surprise you. Yeah, and even though we did, you know, did it set in the 70s, I know that nowadays a lot of the films that are having a film be set in the 70s, they're doing all this, you know, real grainy post-production and putting grain on the film to make it look like a real film look. And, you know, originally that was kind of the idea to have that. But then I started watching all the old films now, and they've all been remastered. And they're all gorgeous. Like we were watching Jaws and even the not last House on the Left, but there was another one. Oh, Spit on Your Grave, the one from the 70s. They're all done and now they're beautiful and they look so pretty. And I'm like, why don't we make a film and just make it look grainy and shitty? You know, like I wanted my film to be pretty too. So now all the new, the old 70s movies do look pretty. So I was like, I'm still gonna make it pretty. It'll still have a little grain. We changed the grain when people were getting killed. We did add a grain onto the film post. But yeah, so I still wanted it to look like a good quality film.
So on that note, where I noticed it was in the flashbacks. You know,
Yes, oh, for
the flashbacks were
sure.
all really upsetting, really
Yes.
triggering, even for a horror movie.
Yeah.
They go on, you know, long enough to really be disturbing, where they want you to look away first, but they never become gratuitous.
Good.
How do you find that balance?
I think just being sensitive to it and, you know, being a woman myself, and I have stepdaughters, and more thinking about a young woman and people watching it, and really just going to the edge, but not going over the edge, you know, like just pushing the envelope just enough. So just, you know, keeping all of that in mind, who's watching it, and being a young woman myself, not wanting that young girl to, you know, to go too far, I guess. Yeah.
And in those flashbacks, what was your decision to make those home movies? I found that really fascinating. It almost disassociated for me anyway. It was like the character disassociating reality from the past.
Yeah. Well, we needed to really wanted to make the flashbacks really different. And for me, I got inspiration, and now I'm going to forget the film. And I loved it. And I fell in love with it. Is it Sinister, the one with Ethan Hawke? I think it was Sin. I think they were they called. I think pretty sure they were called Sinister. And he found these old movies, these projector reels, and he turned it on. And as soon as you heard that and saw the projection, the scary stuff would happen. And I just remember it was so scary. I loved that element of the flashbacks. And that was something that was so important to me that I wanted to have these flashbacks. So there's a new kind of current movie. You're asking if there was any current stuff. So I did get that from that film. Because I just hearing that polar that projector go is just really a spooky sound, right? And so I wanted, that was a spooky thing that was happening to this young girl, right? So I wanted it to sound really creepy and spooky,
Absolutely
definitely.
would.
And have it be totally different. So you knew, okay, now this is back in the 50s when she was young. This is, you know, totally different.
Yeah, no, I like that. There's a moment where Joe talks about sitting around watching old movies, and
Yeah.
it kind of just tied into that for me, where
Yeah.
you know,
Yeah, definitely.
these are things that happen. How much of a learning experience was directing your first film for you, and would you do it again?
I learned so much, and all because of Richard Shankman. And you know, going through the process, and he and I side by side have been together ever since, you know, shooting production as well as post-production, going through the whole process. And if I do direct again, which I wouldn't mind doing, I would definitely give myself a smaller role. If I produce, I would still give myself a smaller role. but yeah, I'm open to it all. I enjoy all of it. And maybe because I'm kind of, I don't want to say I'm a control freak, but I do want to have my hand in, you know, everything if I can. Unless, of course, I'm just an actress on a film, then I'll quietly step back.
I'm sure you'll have a little more respect for the guy behind the camera.
Absolutely. 100%. Yep.
So I've tried to ask the questions that stuck out for me. What about this movie or your experience haven't we talked about that you'd like to discuss?
About my experience with it?
Yep. Something that was important to you or pretty much anything.
Well, because on the line of what we were just talking about figuring out things that and having respect for people behind the camera, when I was on Baywatch, I remember all the time when I'd get my scenes and I'd be so mad and I'd be like, well, why are we doing this scene? Because I'm going to get my hair wet and then I have to go back into hair and makeup and I'm already in this outfit. So why are we going to do the scene at the end of the day when I'm already in this? And I remember I would get so frustrated that they would schedule it like this. But now I know, because when you're in one location, you have to shoot out that location, right? And then if you have only this other actor for this amount of time, you have to shoot them out. And like, you just really learn so much being on the other side. And I will never, ever, ever complain again when I get my sides of what I have to do that day of which scene is which part of the day. So definitely learn a lot of different things.
And my final question, what's next for you?
I am now in the process of doing a series. And this series is being inspired once I went and saw The Sound of Freedom. So I'm really excited about it. And I feel like it's going to be a series that will do good and hopefully have some change. So yeah, that's the project I'm working on now in pre-production on that. So
fantastic.
Yeah.
So Brande, thank you so much for taking time out of your day to talk to me about Wineville.
Thank you. It was my pleasure and thank you so much for having me. Appreciate it.
You're watching Sci-Fi for Me TV.